Ma'am, you can start.
Okay, sir. Good morning, everyone. I am pleased to invite the keynote speaker, Mr. Praveen Singh, and the inquisitive participants across the country to second day's forenoon session of this FDP. Yesterday's session was very productive, and we were able to gain ample and in-depth information regarding core content of data science, journey from manual to business intelligence to AI, of math, business and engineering, machine learning methodology, applications, and major challenges of AI and NLP. We fervently look forward to today's session. I cordially welcome Mr. Praveen Singh to commence the morning session.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Good morning, everyone. So let me share my screen first of all.
1 second, sir. I give permission. 1 second. Okay, sir. Now you can share the screen, sir.
Sure, sure. So you guys are able to see my screen? Sir, is it visible to everyone? Okay, great. So let us move on to machine learning, which I said to you yesterday, the next module is machine learning. So yeah, so today our agenda is going like this. So we'll talk about some sort of introduction of AI and machine learning. Then supervised machine learning, we will look into it, and I will just give you a walkthrough of linear regression, and I will quickly move into the case study of linear regression, so that, because you know, yesterday it was 2 hours, means you have just listened my voice and everything, but you haven't gone through the code and everything. So now what I am thinking, like, I'll start supervised machine learning and I will just give you brief introduction about linear regression, and I'll quickly move into the case study so that at least you can get acquainted with the logic and how exactly we need to perform linear regression in a real time scenario. Okay. Now then I'll quickly move on to the unsupervised machine learning. I'll give you a walkthrough about clustering and association and what all the evolution, how exactly you are evaluating the machine learning models, what all parameters are need to be considered. And then we'll have a look into the regulation, hyperparameter tuning, what all overfitting are there, how exactly it is being done, how it is being solved. And then we'll quickly move on to the ensemble modeling. This is what the agenda which we have set for the day. Now, so ensemble modeling, I'm gonna cover you gradient boost and, you know, XGBoost and all, like how exactly it is being performed, why VR ADA boost is being used here. So we will cover later on the part. Okay. Now, first of all, let us start with introduction to AI machine learning. So you, everybody knows about father of AI is, who is father of AI, is Alan Turing. Okay. In 1950, he has declared that in the future, there would be a machine that would duplicate human intelligence. So he devised specialized test, which is known as Turing's test, which is used to prove the artificial intelligence in that time, you can say. Now in that test, a human and computer hidden from view would be asked a random identical question. Same question is being asked from both. Now, if the computer was successful, then questioner would be unable to identify whether that particular answer was come from the computer or machine or a human. Okay. Now, this was the test which has been done. Okay. Now, and the Turing test which I was talking about, like in 1995, same way, like interrogator is sitting here and machine is sitting. Now, person is asked like, question. The interrogator is gonna ask question. Now he is unable to identify which one have, means who has given the answer, maybe machine or maybe person. He is unable to identify. So, which requires, you know, natural language knowledge representation and automated reasoning, machine learning, and you can say vision robotics for full test. Now, what is artificial intelligence? So, you know what is artificial intelligence? It is being given by John McCarthy, like It is the science and engineering of making intelligent machines, especially intelligent computer programs, which is quite related to the similar task using computer to understand human intelligence as well. Okay. Now, but what is intelligence? So intelligence is the computational part of the ability to achieve goals in the world, which varying kinds and degree of intelligence occur in people, many people and some machines. Okay. And then here, isn't there a solid definition of intelligence that does not depend on relating it to human intelligence? Is there? Not yet. That's what yesterday we have showed you some of the problems, and you can say like how exactly the what all the challenges are in current scenario or maybe in current time. So the problem is that we cannot yet categorize in general what kind of computational process we want to call intelligent. We understand some of the mechanism of intelligence, not other. Now we can you can even move on to the, if you wanted to know more, then you can just go on to the page which I have referred here. Now, let us again, means there are many people who have decided to define AI in their own terms. So they are like Poulin, who said like the exciting new effort to make computer think machine with minds in the full literal sense. Chekhov said like a field of study that seeks to explain and emulate intelligent behavior in terms of computational processes. Now Rick and Knight, they said like the study of how to make computer do things at which at the point people are better. So yeah, even you can define your own way. Okay. Now focus on actions, avoid philosophical issues such as is the system conscious, etc. So if our system can be more rational than human in some cases, why not? So how exactly we are defining it? System that think like human, system that think rationally, system that act like human, system that act rationally. So means here you can see how exactly you can think, how exactly system can think. And this is what the relation which you can say like, means it's a kind of confusion. Means like later on I am gonna cover the confusion matrix, but this statement is almost, you can say, a replica of that confusion matrix. So we will follow act rationally approach. So act rationally, you have seen the last one, system that act rationally. So distinction may not be that important. Acting rationally like a human presumably requires some sort of thinking rationally like a human. Human more, humans much more rational anyway in complex domain, you can say. But yeah, let us talk about boundaries of AI. So AI, as it means, yesterday I was mentioning about probability and statistic. Engineering, you know very well, algorithm and complexity which comes in your, what is it, as I said, like it comes in your programming language. And then philosophy, logic, linguistic, psychology, neuroscience. Okay, so some human skills being simulated like anticipation, prediction, maybe time series analysis, maybe you can say yesterday you have learned about natural language understanding and generation. Maybe many of you are quite aware about pattern recognition, speech processing, which yesterday we had quite a bit discussion about it. And then problem solving and creativity. Okay. Now, AI benefits from lot of other disciplines. So that's what yesterday we have gone through, like AI in healthcare, AI in insurance, and AI in computer science. So means like there are lot many things where means you can see like AI benefits actually. Perhaps especially in recent history, stats, economic, and computer science theory. So results in
Raveen.
Yes, sir. Rajesh, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I think Praveen sir disconnected, sir. Let's call him once.
Yes, call him. Okay, sure.
Yeah, sir. Sari is available, sir. One second.
Okay.
Yeah, Praveen, sir. I think I have.
Sorry, actually, I lost my connectivity.
Yeah. Okay. No problem, sir. Yeah, you can.
Yeah. Oh, so let me make me host so that I can share.
Yeah, you can share now, sir.
So you get yeah. Everybody able to see my screen?
Yes, sir. It is visible, sir.
Okay, great. Sorry, I actually lost my internet. So no problem now. So let us quickly move on to the next slide. Yeah, so AI, you can say in different subject area. So this particular diagram which shows like means people have a lot of confusion about that. Like how exactly you can define AI, in which field actually AI exists. So I'm just wanted to clear about it's a deep learning and if you are doing deep learning and predictive analytics, that is a part of machine learning, which is directly connected to AI. As yesterday you have seen one of the speaker where I have mentioned like it's a subset of AI. Machine learning is a subset of AI. Now, when it comes to the like yesterday you have seen like classification, clustering, and maybe information extraction, which I have showed you somewhat, translation, which Google does and Baidu does. These are the NLP. So which also going to relate with AI. Now speech to text, text then expert system, planning and scheduling and optimization, that is also comes in AI. Robotics, everybody aware about robotics, which also are part of AI. Image recognition and machine vision, that is also called as one field which is known as vision, also part of AI. So now major AI area which I know like most of you guys are quite aware about it. It's a machine learning, deep learning, natural language processing, which speech understanding, which we have covered already, natural language processing, which already we have covered. Now robotics and sensory system, computer vision and scene recognition, expert system, which is quite, you know, long back it is being used. Now people are in bank, still they are using it. Now let us just have a look on a simplified AI landscape. So now you can see here chatbots, which are based on natural language processing. Now you can see automated insight, which is totally based on machine learning and natural processing with structured data. Now, as you are quite aware about Tesla, SpaceX, so it is autopilot by Tesla, like machine learning, which is totally based on machine learning with unstructured data and situational awareness. So yeah, means like their car, which is autopilot actually. So you can think in that way. Now AlphaGo, which is nothing but the Google parent company, which completely you can say it's a completely dependent on, or maybe it is entire company is totally means they are coming up with all the technique and technology with who are quietly related to machine learning or neural network, you can say. Now Watson, I don't know any of you are aware about it, but you can say Watson is a IBM product. IBM Watson, it is known as IBM Watson, which has machine learning capability along with speech processing. And this capability of speech processing is not just with structured data. They have a structured plus unstructured data capability also. So as you can go on towards the right, you can say like it is going toward the deep AI. Okay. Earlier, like as I said, like chatbots and all, this is a narrow AI. You can say like it's just a natural processing. Okay, just you move towards right, you will see like that is you are continuously adding some more machine learning techniques, AI techniques into that. So that means they are continuously learning and means you are feeding more into that. So it has coming up with the more, you know, combination of machine learning, speech recognition, combination of machine learning, natural language processing, combination of various things. Okay. Now here you can see like we have listed couple of organization, or maybe you can say famous organization, so which are like machine learning generally 96 companies which are listed here. If you will Google, you will easily find it out. Now there are apps which are totally dependent on machine learning. So these are the companies which I have mentioned, which generally develop all the apps which are quite based on machine learning. And then computer vision, all the apps which are quite related to computer vision. So these are the things. Now company which are totally focused on the computer vision app, so I have listed there. Now company which are developing smart robots, so I have mentioned here, though I have mentioned very few, but out of that, you know, 52, I am unable to capture all the images into it. And there are many more things, like even for gesture control, for recommendation engine, you can see here. I don't know, many of you are quite aware about many of them. Companies like these are the, this is not like strange company. These are the company which are still in the market, and we are quite heard a lot about these companies. I don't know about, means like you guys are quite familiar with it, but yeah, I have done, see, iRobot, I know the company. Even there are multiple like Inventa, which I am quite aware about. And there are Gawker, we are aware about, how is it work. Sense network, which are quite based on machine learning app, and they are multimodal. So you can say like, these are the, just we wanted to show you like, it's not like nobody is putting their effort into it. I just wanted to show you there are multiple organizations. Yeah, you can say like more than thousands or maybe even more are the organization which are quietly working since long time into AI domain. Okay. So it's not like means you cannot work or you cannot think on it. Okay, now let us have a look into what is machine learning. So machine learns pattern in the training data using input features, which means, you know, I will show you how exactly it will learn. Then pattern learn applied to unseen data to ensure generalization. Generally, we develop model which is quite generalizable. Now, if generalization fails, then input feature need to be modified and we need to train using more data. Okay. Now, means you can say like either regression or classification, whatever you wanted to perform, you can perform. Now let us introduce in such a way that like introduction to machine learning, which is the art of making machine intelligent without explicit programming. Okay, how exactly it will does? It has three field, which is like you have to execute some task. Execute some task means your model. Okay, your classification algorithm or maybe your regression algorithm means your algorithm part. So you wanted to execute that algorithm part. Now, how will you improve that algorithm? You can improve that algorithm for what? By model performance. So we kept it as a performance, but with what you are going to improve that? With the data you are going to improve that. So that data we are calling as experience. Okay. So these three TPE, you can say, these are the three fields, how exactly you can build your machine learning algorithm and you can define your machine learning algorithm. Or maybe you can say like complete machine learning, you can define in such a way that task, performance, experience, and these has to be continuously, you know, these are all, you can say like interrelated with each other. Now I'm just giving you broadly brief how exactly machine learning process works. So, you know, data providers can be, data can be means provided by maybe sensor, maybe it is placed in some other server, or maybe it is means like you are getting from some financial organization, or maybe you are getting from some bureau organization. Some means data is being there, you are collecting those data from various providers. Now you get that data which you have gotten, that is a raw data, means that is not purified version. That is means you still, you need to do lot many things into that data, because that is, you know, maybe you can say like it's not that much useful. Now you are going to make it useful. So yesterday I was talk about lot means how exactly you have to remove missing value, how exactly you need to perform data engineering, you have you directly need to perform feature engineering. There are a lot many things which here only it comes. So here pre-processing. So now we have data pre-processing tool. So many data pre-processing here. I'm not gonna tell you about pre-processing tool, but here we will do pre-processing through Python only. So means we are going to use pandas, we are going to use numpy to do data pre-processing things. Now in multiple organization people do use, there are multiple tools which do automatic pre-processing. So means I'm not going to use, because if I'm going to use that pre-processing tool, then it won't make sense for you, because you need to understand how exactly pre-processing is being done. So you are converting actually what you are doing with pre-processing, you are converting everything in a structured data. Suppose you are getting raw data that might be unstructured data. Now you are converting into structured data. Maybe you are getting semi-structured data. You are converting into structured data. Now this particular step, you need to perform it in iterative manner. Now once you get that structured data, you need to feed this particular data to the learning algorithm. Learning algorithm, your maybe machine learning, linear regression, maybe logistic regression, maybe classification, clustering, whatever. It depends on you, means what exactly the use case do you have in your hand. Now, once you got that, you need to get the best model out of it. So to get best model, you need to keep on iterating your steps. Okay, now you got best model, then you have to deploy that selected model to, and then that has to be named as golden model, you can say. Okay, and then it is being going to productionize. Once it is going to be productionized, that production is nothing but your application. Maybe application is in your mobile app, or maybe application is in your web form. So this is entire process. Okay, now so data pre-processing is how exactly need to be done. So data cleansing, data deduplication, data analysis, data standardization, data normalization, quality check. So how these are the steps which are quite in iterative manner. As in the previous slide, I have keep on mentioning, like this is the iterative process. So now you are going to do data integration. You are collecting from everywhere. Okay, now doing data integration. Now perform some data transformation, maybe normalization, maybe aggregation, and maybe you need to generalize it. Perform data transformation. Once you do that, maybe there are a couple of rows or maybe a couple of columns are which is quite not useful, or maybe those columns are quite redundant. Then you need to perform data reduction steps. Now once you do that, now you have to perform data cleaning. Data cleaning means you need to remove some of the not useful rows, or maybe you need to remove column which has more number of missing values. So these are the steps which you need to look into it, and how exactly you need to perform, I will show you in the code. Now, so let us basically give you a brief about supervised, unsupervised, reinforcement, and learning. How exactly it is? So supervised, when you have labeled data, okay, and you require direct feedback, you are going to predict outcome, or maybe you can say like it's a future. Okay, now when we talk about unsupervised machine learning, then there is no labeled data and there is no feedback kind of thing, and the structure which you are thinking which are already hidden. Okay, so you need to find that hidden structure there. Now reinforcement, it's a decision process, or maybe you can say like it's a reward system. Maybe you are doing some sort of, you know, good thing, and based on that means they are incrementing the things, and means once you got feedback, they are incrementing the counter, and based on that counter, one day you will get some reward. Okay, and learn series of action, as I means it's the decision process. So you know, like there are multiple actions are there which need to be performed on a sequence manner, you can say. So these are the broadly you can say, which means like we have showed you through this slide. Now this is pretty much, you know, famous. I don't know, famous slide means I have taken from the web only. Now here you can say like machine learning has multiple things like neural network, regularization, rule system, regression. So regression, you can see like which we are going to target here. Regression has multiple things like linear regression, ordinary least square regression, stepwise regression, multivariate, adaptive reasoning regression, spline, logistic regression. And then you can see if we will talk about decision tree having like CART, or maybe you can say like C 4.5, 5.0, or maybe you can say conditional decision tree and all. Now, when you talk about instance based, that k nearest neighbor, learning vector of quantization, and locally weighted learning. Clustering, you know, pretty much you are quite aware about k-means, k-medians, and hierarchical clustering. So these are the, just wanted to show you like how exactly the branches of machine learning algorithm are elaborated, or maybe you can say means can be categorized. So we are going to cover in example also random forest, gradient boost machines, boosting, and then add a boost and all. Now let us sit and focus one by one all the techniques. Okay, so now I'm gonna tell you type of machine learning techniques. You can say here we all aware about like supervised and unsupervised. Now training, where training is done using label data called as supervised learning. Now here the algorithm learns from the mapping function from the input to the output. Okay, which you can say like y equal to fx. Now example can be a regression, okay, where you used to predict continuous variable, that is, that say, let's say revenue of a company on a particular segment. Okay, you wanted that. Now classification, now which is used to predict categorical variables. So this is what the difference is. You wanted to predict continuous variable using regression. You wanted to predict categorical variable, that is classification. Now that means you wanted to classify incoming mails as spam or non-spam. So these are the pretty much simple examples which I am just wanted to show you so that you can easily correlate with the algorithm. Now unsupervised machine learning, where training is being done through unlabeled data. Now algorithms are left to their own device to discover and present the interesting structure in the data. Now example, as I said, like clustering. So used to discover the inherent grouping in the data, that you can say customer segmentation. You wanted to do some customer segmentation. You might have a different customer. Customer belongs to, maybe customer belongs to marketing, maybe customer belongs to sales, maybe customer belongs to various segment. Now association, used to discover rules that describe large portion of the data, that is market basket analysis, which is pretty much famous. I don't know, means like you guys are quite aware about that association or not, but let me give you example. You when you walk towards you can say any shopping mall, or maybe you can say like DMart, means I am pretty much sure. So you guys are from Guntur or Guntur, I guess. Anyway, means I don't know whether DMart is there or not, but yeah, when you walk into the DMart, you must have seen like wherever you will see the milk is placed, they have that store in milk. So must be there, they must be placing bread along with the milk. Why? Because people will think, and they are also associated the thing like, if you will buy milk, there must be some sort of, you know, bread, which maybe you gonna take when you will take milk. Now if you have seen like there are wherever the tea packet or tea bags are placed, must be there is nearby place, which means they are also keeping in sugar as well. Okay, if you means you have observed, then please observe. Means like if you have observed, then that is a good thing, but if you haven't observed, then please go and walk into that and let's see means how exactly it is being. Now they are doing a lot of marketing on that part. Okay, they are investing a huge amount of money to know which part is correlated actually. Now leave about this. Now suppose you are walking to the DMart with your kids. Now if you must have seen like counter, when you are going to pay the cash, or maybe you're paying through the credit card, you are going to the counter. In counter, if you must have seen, I don't know whether you guys have observed it or not, but in the counter they have kept lot of chocolates. Okay, lot of toys. Why they have kept lot of toys? Because they knew like if you people are coming up here with your kids, and if your kids will say, mama, dada, can you provide me chocolate? Can you give me chocolate? You are not going to tell no, you don't need, and something like, maybe I don't know, means there are multiple type of parents which will say like, no, you don't need this chocolate. But I'm pretty much sure out of 100, 90% of people will give the chocolate to your kid. Okay, and if there is a nearby any toys, you will ask like, oh, take that toys as well. Or maybe your kid will cry in front of you and by saying like, mom, I need this toy. So this is entire analysis is being performed by none other than data scientists, or maybe you can say data analyst people. Okay, they are doing this kind of analysis so that people will attract with that and they will buy, because at the counter you will pay, and nothing is there if you are buying almost 2500 of means maybe your groceries of around 2000, then getting a chocolate in 25 rupees or maybe 50 rupees is not a big deal for you, and everybody knows about it. So that is why they are keeping it to that place. Now let us move on for the supervised learning. So I'm just going to give you supervised machine learning regression. Now, so regression is the technique that determines the relationship between one or more independent variable and dependent variables. Okay, so regression is like, it can be one or more than one independent variable. Okay, and with whom you are going to give a relationship? With a dependent variable. Now, naming style means the people are using dependent, target, output, or maybe criteria variables. Now, when there are multiple people are using independent, input, predictor. Okay. Now, I'm just going to give you linear and nonlinear, what exactly it is. So in linear, simple linear regression, which has only one independent variable. Now, multiple linear regression, it pretty much explanatory through the word only multiple. So two or more independent variable. Now, nonlinear regression, it dependent on linear transformation of independent variable. Okay. Now, simple linear regression. Now, in simple linear regression, we try to fit the best line between the dependent variables and the independent variables. So, which is given as, let's say, y equal to mx plus c. Okay. Now, m equal to coefficient of x, you can say, and c is nothing but your intercept. So you can see in the pretty much here diagram where you are just, I'm just describing the intercept. Okay. What is intercept? What is slope here? And coefficient of not coefficient. What is coefficient here? It is means, as I mentioned, it is M. Now M, how you are going to define M, or how you are going to calculate M? M is what? M is your coefficient. So that the change in Y divided by the change in x. So that how you can calculate the coefficient. So as you can see, so towards this x axis, you will get x change. Now towards y axis, you will get y change. So delta x, delta y. Now divided by delta y is being divided by delta x, you will get what? M. That is nothing but our coefficient. Now, once you get the coefficient, you need to get intercept. You can see like between 50 and 60 there is intercept. Okay, maybe that point is like 58 or maybe 56, whatever you can define by your own. Okay, now how you will get best slope, which gives minimal sum of squared error? That is how you need to know. So I have seen, if above the line there are some point, okay, scattered over there, then that is called as positive error term. If below that line, which I have mentioned through the red line, that is also known as negative error terms. Okay, this is how actually you have to build your linear regression. Now, few points which will like tell you how exactly you will calculate your best line. So I must say, you can calculate using ordinary least square, which I'm gonna use here. Okay. Now, a best line is a line that fits the given scatter plot in the best way. Okay, so means suppose you have a scatter plot. Now I please don't ask a scatter plot, because in the very first day I have mentioned about a scatter plot. Now your point are scattered around the line, let's say. Now you have to make a line which fits almost all the points. Almost I'm saying, not I'm saying, I means you have to fix all the points. Okay, so the line which fits all the points in a given scatter plot, that will give you the best line. Okay, now that best line is being obtained by minimizing a quantity which is known as nothing but the residual sum of square, or maybe you can say error terms, sum of squares of errors. Okay, now here we'll talk more about linear regression. So as I said, like y is nothing but your dependent variable, and beta 1 beta 0 is your nothing but your what, coefficient, linear component, you can say, like it's a coefficient actually. At that, combination of beta 1x plus beta 0 is your linear component. Okay, and where xi is your nothing but the independent variable. Now here error term is epsilon I, which I am mentioning here. Now as I said in the previous diagram, you can say like beta 1 we are getting the slope here, beta 0 it's your nothing but the intercept. Okay, so now the equation of the best fit regression line is equal, y equal to beta 0 plus beta 1, which can be found by minimizing the cost function. Ultimately our goal is what? To minimize the cost function. So here RSS is that cost function, you can say. So using ordinary least square, which I have mentioned in the previous slide, ordinary least square is the method which we are using for minimizing the cost function. Okay, and you know there are multiple ways to do that. Maybe you can do through differentiation, and maybe you can do through gradient descent. Now the strength of this entire linear regression model is mainly explained by R square. I will show you how to calculate that, and I will show you how exactly where R square is being placed a major role. Now R square is being calculated using 1 minus RSS sum divided by TSS. So RSS is what? Residual sum of squares. Residual sum of square means it's a sum of squares of error terms. Now TSS is total sum of squares. Okay, yeah, make sure whatever R square lies between 0 and 1, where 1 implies that the variance in the data is being explained by the model. Okay, so when it comes to 1, that means variance in the data, okay, is being totally explained by the model. But if it is 0, that means none of the variance value is being explained by the model. And truly speaking, and I have written it means like by mentioning, obviously it is very difficult to achieve either of the extreme values. Either 0, you can't get either 0, you can't get means totally 1. Now let me talk about few of the terms which is being defined when you are getting summary of the statistics. So when you are using OLS or maybe any model, I mean like you are performing any sort of thing, so you are getting these parameters, or you can say like these are the parameter which plays a crucial role while choosing your model. Okay, so F statistic, the parameter is being used instead of testing the significance of each of the betas. It tells whether the overall model fit is significant or not. This F statistic is being quietly used when you will talk about multiple linear regression model, because the number of betas are quite high. Okay, so as I said, for linear regression, beta is what? Number of beta is quite 1. No, but in multiple regression, beta is quite high. So there you don't need to go to one by one all betas. You just need to get overall significance of a model fit. So F statistic can give you that. Okay, so now sometimes it happens like all betas are significant, okay, but the model fit happen just by luck or maybe just by a chance. That line may just luckily fit the data, you never know. So that is why we need F statistic. Now how you will calculate and how you will evaluate that. So probability of F statistic is if it is less than 0.05, that means your overall model fit is significant. And if it is greater than 0.5, then you can say like, we need to review again the same model. We need to perform some other steps. Now, another term you can say R squared, which tells you how much variance in the data has been explained by the model. Okay. It depends on, suppose you are getting value 0.81 or 0.816. That means 81.6% of variance in the data has been explained by the model. It depends on that. And R squared is totally saying about the variance only. Now, coefficient and p-values. So the p-value of the coefficient tells whether the coefficient is significant or not. So see, you can say I have showed you coefficient. So in simple linear regression, coefficient is 1. But in multiple regression, multiple coefficients. How do you actually define the coefficient and how exactly you will perform the test in that? So what I'm doing, the p-value of the coefficient tells whether the coefficient is significant or not. Okay, if the p-value is less than 0.05, then you can say coefficient is significant. I will show you that part as well. Now, before doing this these things, you can say linear regression model thing. Just a second, okay. Yeah, linear regression model. You can say like, you need to perform these other things, which I must say like to verify or to validate your model. So assumption is while performing simple linear regression is X and Y should display some sort of linear relationships. Then only you can go with linear regression. Okay. Now error terms. So error terms, residuals are normally distributed with mean zero, or you can say centered around zero. So this is a very important part. Always you need to perform this. So you need to see whether my error terms are normally distributed or not. Okay, you need to see that and whether it is quite centered around zero or not. Now, using this, how will you perform this? You need, yesterday we have talked about histogram of the error terms. Now, you need to perform that. Guys, please switch off your video. It's better because it would be a bandwidth issue. Otherwise, people may face bandwidth issue. Now, when I talk about error terms, you can see here, you can plot error terms using histogram. Yesterday, I have given you the somewhat means like just about how exactly you need to perform histogram. Now, second thing, you can say error terms should be independent of each other. There should not be any dependency between error terms. Okay. Now, third one is error term have a constant variance, which is also known as homogeneity. Okay. That means the variance should not increase or decrease as the error value changes. It should not follow any pattern as the error term change. That means your error terms should have a constant variance. Okay, now these are the assumptions which you need to keep in mind while performing simple linear regression. Now, before moving to multiple linear regression, let me give you a walkthrough about linear regression model. So screen share has stopped. Okay, now let me share my screen. Hello, can you make me host, sir? I am unable to present the screen. Sir, can you make me host? Yeah, thank you. So let me give you a simple linear regression model case study. Now, here we can go now. Let me give you a simple linear regression model, how exactly we need to build. So now I am going to build linear regression model to predict sales using an appropriate predictor variables. Now, here our important steps is, you need to first read and understand the data. So let us do the following steps. What you need to do here, You need to import data using Panda libraries, understand the structure of the data. So that's what in the beginning I showed you how exactly you need to read and understand the data. Now, when we talk about reading, you can say like two main libraries, which I was earlier used to say like you need to have a look. So two libraries which you need to look is NumPy and Pandas. Now, here I am reading CSV file. CSV file is being placed here, like advertising CSV. So I have kept in the same folder, so I don't need to mention another path. Now, advertising is just a reading pd.read.csv. Once you do that, you can see here, I can see my data part. Once you see that data part, it has TV, radio, newspaper, and sales. Okay. So I have just printed top five rows, you can say. Now let's inspect that various aspect. So it has number of rows, it has 200, and columns has 4. Column are TV, radio, newspaper, and sales, you can say. Now, if we will see here, let me just have a look into what exactly my data has the columns, means in what type of columns do we have. So you can see TV has non-filled float values. Okay, radio has a float values, sales has a float values, newspaper has a float values. So everything has a float values. Now, let us describe our advertising, means what our data frame which we have created here is advertising. Now let's describe it. So describe will give you mean, minimum value, maximum value, 25% of that value, 50% of that value, count of that. You can see here, minimum value of TV is 0.70, radio is like this. Okay, maximum is like this, 296 and 49 is radio. Okay, so these are the pretty much just I have performed few steps to know about my data. Okay, and just I wanted to understand about my data now. So step two is visualizing the data, which I said how exactly you need to use it. You need to perform a scatter plot out of that. Now, as I mentioned yesterday, like matplotlib, I'm gonna use for entire case study, or maybe wherever I will show you. Now I'm using import matplotlib.pyplot splt. Okay, and then I'm importing seaborn. Seaborn, which is nothing but the built on top of the matplotlib, which I have told you yesterday. Now, we are visualizing our data using seaborn. So we will first make a pair plot for all the variable presenting to visualize which variable are most correlated to sales. Okay, now we need to see which variables is quite most correlated to sales. Now, I have plotted TV. Okay, TV versus sales. This plot is TV versus sales. You can see this is, you can see quite, it is linearly related to the sales. Now newspaper, it is scattered around everywhere. So it is not at all, I'm not able to define anything, whether it is dependent on sales or not. Radio, still radio, I can't comment on it because it is still, it is not able to, means it is also scattered all over. You cannot comment on like whether it is linearly dependent or not. Now, let us move into heat map. You can see heat map, radio versus TV, radio versus TV versus sale has 0.9. Okay, now what else having more correlation? I'm not able to see. Okay, so you can see I have mentioned here, as it is visible from the pair plot that the heat map, the variable TV, okay, the variable TV seems to be most correlated with the sales, which I told you it's a 0.9 correlation. Now, so let's go ahead and perform simple linear regression using TV. So here, I just wanted to define like how exactly my terms are being. Now, Here we are going to perform simple linear regression. Now equation of simple linear regression is y equal to mx plus c. So now here I am just mentioning m1 x1 m2 x2 and m3 xp, and I have mentioned like y is our response variable, c is our intercept, m1 is our the coefficient of the first feature, m2 is our coefficient of the next feature. Just keep on saying, means like similarly you can say mn x, how exactly. Now here the m is nothing but the values which call the model coefficient, or you can say model parameter. Okay, so here m which is the coefficient. So here we are saying like m values are called the model coefficient. Now you keep on going, we need to perform some generic steps in model building using stat model. So now we first assign the feature variable tv in the case to the variable x. Okay, now so advertising our data frame, out of that I am giving tv one of the column to the x, and y is our sales. Now just we are doing train and test split. Now you will need to split our variable into training and test set. You will perform this by importing train test split from sklearn.modelselection library, and it is usually a good practice to keep 70% of the data in your train data set and rest 30% in your test data set. So we need to just import the library, okay, from sklearn. We are doing train test split. Now you need to perform, you will get x train, x text, x train, y test by doing train test split. Now once you get that, you just need to check like what I am getting in train.head. So I just wanted to know like what is in my train, x train. So these are the values which I am getting. Now what is in your y train? The sales value which I am able to see. Now keep on, now you need to build a linear model. Now once you first need to import the statsmodel.api library using which you will perform the linear regression. So you need to import statsmodel.api. why I am performing this? So that I can show you some more parameter. So by default the statsmodel library fit a line on a dataset which passes through the origin. Okay, but in order to have an intercept you need to manually use the add constant we are going to use. Now attribute of a statsman, and once you have added the constant of your x-train data set, you can go ahead with the fit a regression line using OLS, which is nothing but the ordinary least square. Now I am doing here x-train, I am just adding a constant to get an intercept. So SM, which is already here, stats model API dot add constant, I am adding constant to the x-train data. Now it's time to fit the regression line using OLS. So I am just fitting that line through passing y train comma x train sm, because constant is being added here. Now perform dot fit. Now you get parameter. Now print the parameter is nothing but where we are going to get intercept and slope of the regression line. So I am getting here constant which is 6.9 and tb which is 0.05. okay, now what next? I am going to give you lr.summary. Now we are performing summary operation list out of all the different parameter of the regression line fitted. Now you can see here summary. So I have explained about F statistic and probability of F statistic. Okay, I have explained about it. Now I have talked about p value, which is mentioned here, and I have talked about coefficient, which is mentioned here. Okay, and I have also talked about R square. So as I said, R square value is 0.816. So according to the definition, it is saying 81% is being what it is being. If you will look into the R square value, means my R square definition, it tells you how much variance in the data has been explained by the model. So you can see 81% of the variance is of the data is being explained by our model. Okay, Now, so this is what the statistics which you get from OLS. Now, if you will quickly go on, I will tell you what exactly the value are we concerned are the coefficient and significance, R square and F statistic, and its significance. So that is what, that is why I just explained about F statistic, coefficient, and R square and P values. Now let us move into the value. First, the coefficient of TV is 0.04 with a very low P value. Okay. Now you can see coefficient of TV is 0.045 and p value is 0.00, which is less than 0.05. That means the variable is significant. The coefficient is significant. You can say like it's a significant. Now R square, as I mentioned, it's 18.816. So it is 81.6% of the variance in the sales explained by TV. You can say it means 81.6% of the variance in the sales is explained by TV. Okay. TV is our one of the variables. Okay. Now, F statistic, which has very low P value. You can say here, P value is almost zero for F statistic. So here, see probability of P value, you can say here, it is almost zero, so which is also less than 0.05, you can say. Now, so that is why it is quite significant. So we got this. Now here, if you will see, we have got M and here somewhere C, we got 6.9 and 10.05. now, and here you got 0.0 and 0.69, 6.9. So you will use 2.9, okay, and 0.054 into T. Now I am going to plot this. Okay, I am going to plot sales. Now I'm plotting this into a scatter plot by mentioning comma 6.948, because now my point is become so 6.9405 into extent. You can see here. So this line is almost passing through all the points, or which is quite very near to that. That means we are minimizing the error term, or we have to use plt.plot for x trend and y trend, and then plt.show. So now let us look and analyze the residual, which we had quite a lot discussion on it. To validate our assumption, we need to perform these things. So now, distribution of the error terms. So we need to check the error terms are now also normally distributed, which is in fact the assumption of linear regression. So let us plot the histogram of the error terms and see what it looks like. So as I said, like we need to plot error term, histogram of error term. So this is the histogram for error term. Here it is normally distributed, okay, and centered about zero. Centered about mean of zero, you can. Okay, so to plot this, we just use y trend predict, allow dot predict, and then you need to get residual. You will get how is y trend dot predict, means it's error term, mean like what actual prediction is there and what exactly the actual value. Now I'm just using this distance plot. Now I'm mentioning error terms here and giving 15 bins. Just give some titles to this error terms I have given, and then plot x label as well as y label. So now this we have performed. Now the second assumption which I said to you, looking at the patterns of the residuals. So now you need to look error terms. So this is scattered all over. So by scattered or you are not able to see any pattern. So that means this is fine for us. So now I have written here, we are confident that the model fit isn't not by a chance and has decent predictive power. The normality of the residual terms allows some inference on the coefficient, although the variance of the residual increasing with x indicate that is there is significant. Okay, now you need to perform prediction on the test set. So now prediction on the test set is how you are going to use. You have to just make add constant to the test set you are adding here, and then just predicting your phi values of corresponding test. Okay, so you get these values. Now you need to look few more matrix. So nothing but R squared, mean squared error, and R2 squared. Now looking at the root mean squared error value, here you are getting 2.0, and then check value on the test set, it's 0.79, which is pretty much acceptable. Now let us visualize the fit on the test set. How exactly this is being line is being fitted to the our test set. So you can see still it is covering almost all the points with minimizing the error. So we are pretty much clear about it now. So that linear regression is also can be performed using sklearn. So in sklearn I have just mentioned like how exactly you can perform it through sklearn. So these are the quite steps which you can see. So here also I am just getting intercept and coefficient. Here I am just calling linear regression function here by just fitting xtrain lm and ytrain lm, which is nothing but the linear regression model, and then you are getting this five. So you are getting almost same intercept as well as coefficient. Okay, so now I don't know, means you must have some questions. What is R square, why it is called R squared based on what we have learned so far, do you see it? So now means I have just giving you what exactly R square, it's like 81% sign, which is nothing but the correlation. Pearson is called R, or Pearson's R, which is 81.6, you can say. Okay, what is good RMSE? Is there some RMSE that I should aim for? You should be able to answer this by now, you can say. So RMSE is nothing but depend on the unit of the y variable. It is not a normalized measure. Okay, so a better measure R squared, which is normalized measure. Okay, now this is what I just wanted to show you. Now let me show you my slides. So yeah, as I have mentioned, R squared, coefficient, and p values, f statistics. I have totally defined you what exactly it is. So this assumption we have already showed you, error terms are normally distributed with mean zero or centered around it, and error terms are should be independent of each other, means there is should not be any pattern which present. So error term have a constant variance, that means the variance should not be increase or decrease, or maybe you can say it shouldn't follow any sort of pattern. Now this is fine. Now guys, I'm just giving a pause here, and just I wanted to know like how many of you have any question. Please raise your hand and please raise your voice. Sir, please allow them to ask question. Guys, yes, please sir. Please raise your hand and please ask if you
are having the doubts regarding the session of the last 1 hour. You can raise your hand so that we will unmute you, so that you can directly speak to Praveen sir, and also Raj sir is also available in the meeting. So please raise your hand if you want to ask any doubts.
Please let me know if you wanted to ask any doubt regarding the case study which I have showed you, or regarding the PPT which from the morning onwards I am showing you, and maybe if you have some doubt on yesterday's slides, please let us know. Because you know means why I was giving you a walkthrough about my case study is because yesterday 2 hours and today's almost 1 hour. So I thought like you may get bored because everything is theoretical. So I don't believe in theory always. I generally give everything through practical. So I love coding and I even try to do the same thing through coding everything. So I just wanted to visualize you guys how exactly the code looks like in linear regression and how exactly POC you can do.
Or also if you don't want to speak, you can also text in the chat box.
Yeah, please, if anybody having any doubt, please text on the chat. Or if you really wanted me to connect means later on after the means maybe session, please, I'm just mentioning my mail ID here. You can please be in touch with me if you have any query, any doubt, please, any project related query, please. But yeah, please ask questions. I don't know whether how many of you have got this grasp or not, but truly speaking, I have put my best effort on it, and because of you guys only, I have built an entire case study to show you, and I have mentioned in each step, I have mentioned my comments so that you will get better understanding of each lines which I have mentioned it. So guys, please ask if you have any doubt. So, sir, I'm not able to see anybody is interested in asking questions. So let it be. Maybe at the end of the session, maybe they will ask. Don't know.
Sir, I think no one is ready to ask.
Yeah. Anything. Yeah. Okay. Then we'll move on. Okay.
Yeah. Okay, sir. If you continue, sir, in the end, we will ask again for the questions.
Yeah. Sure. So. Are you able to see my slide? Yeah, perfectly. Now let us move on to
sir. Someone has questioned, sir. I think Nagul Mira Sayed. Semi-supervised machine. Yeah. What is the meaning of semi-supervised machine learning?
So semi-supervised machine learning, when you you are not pretty much sure about either it's a supervised or it's a unsupervised. So it is in the between of semi. It means like supervised and unsupervised. Means like there are multiple things like. You can say like there are labels, some labels you can identify, or maybe there is a hidden pattern, but that is not, you are not sure like there is a hidden pattern. You are getting something out of it, but still you need to find some pattern more. So that is how you can define it. And you truly speaking, there are so many things you can say. Multiple things are there. Okay. So people can define their own way, like means even truly speaking, I can say I can't comment on this, means like what exactly you can define in semi-supervised, but I must say like it is in between of both of them. But yeah, as I said, like there are multiple things, there are pattern which is quite visible to identify, or maybe you wanted to discover, but there is a visibility of that. Okay.
Yeah, Ramakrishna Gandhi, sorry, muted, sir.
Yes, sir. Ramakrishna, sir, please go on. Ramakrishna, sir, please go on.
Sir, one second, sir. They are not. And there is one more question in the chat box, sir. Please answer that one. Ramakrishna,
hello? Gandhi, sir. You are unmuted, sir. This is Ramakrishna, sir.
Yes, sir.
Could we generate a new model, sir? Could we generate a new model to compare with other models? Okay, based on that root mean square error.
Yeah, right.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, right. You can do that.
You can design models that models can be run in Python. That means using Anaconda Navigator.
Yeah, you can do that.
Okay, so is it how to do that? Could you that means any ideas, sir?
So see, what you will do on the same data set, you try to build another model, okay, and you try to perform this RMSE or R square value, so with the same. Once you do that, you will come to know the what is R square I am getting in this model, what is R square I was getting in that previous model. Now you compare both, and you will come to know like what exactly it is. Okay, so which one is suitable for you and which one is quite giving better accuracy? We generally do that. Even in means like maybe in coming case study, I will show you how exactly I am comparing two different models.
With the same. Okay. Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you. No problem. Yeah. Any other question, please?
Sir, there is one more question in the chat box. Differences between reinforcement and semi-supervised ML.
Okay. So yeah. So as I mentioned, in reinforcement, you need proper, you know, continuously feedback, and there is royalty point which you can say, which you keep on getting. Okay, and you can say like. In reinforcement, everything it depends on the what, like means like feedback or maybe continuous learning from, you know, feedback. You can say like keep on learning from the feedback, you can say. Now in case of semi unsupervised or maybe semi supervised, there means, you know, it combines a small amount of labeled data with a large amount of unlabeled data. Or in case of unsupervised, you can say a small amount of unlabeled data and large amount of labeled data using for it. It is using during the training, you can say. Okay. So yeah, so which is pretty much simple, means you can even think in that line which I'm talking about. So don't worry much. Sorry for that, because reinforcement I'm not going to cover in this entire session. Maybe if you want, I can elaborate, means like maybe I can keep one slide for that. But yeah, I'm not gonna give you about reinforcement learning and all, because, you know, reinforcement is being it's being used in so many places right now. You can say like when you order something, means order from Zomato or maybe Swiggy, they keep on asking you, give a feedback, okay, how the order is. Now the by giving you feedback, they are taking that feedback to just rate, to give the rating of your restaurant from where you have ordered. Okay, so now to give the rating continuously, to show their restaurant rating, they can use that feedback as a rating. Okay, so this is how exactly they wanted to do the reinforcement, you can say. Okay. Now, what is the training set and test set in machine learning?
Yes, sir. One more person is waiting, sir.
Please.
Ma'am, Jyoti Dainek, ma'am, please unmute yourself. You can unmute yourself now. Please unmute yourself and ask the question. Jyoti Dainek.
Hello.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah,
ma'am. Ma'am.
Good morning, sir. Actually, what is meaning of unsupervised data? Is unsupervised data is unstructured data or raw data?
So I must see, it's a unsupervised data. That doesn't mean like it's a, you can say undirected data. It doesn't have anything, means like you have everything is in hidden, or you can say it's a unlabeled data. Okay.
Huh.
So there is no output variables, you can say, which you wanted to predict. So you need to get some output from it. It means you need to find, you need to uncover that hidden pattern. Okay. In that way you can relate it.
Okay, sir. My second question is, what is meaning of actual label data in supervised data?
Actual label data in?
Supervised data. Supervised data means label data.
Yeah, supervised data means label data.
Then what is meaning of label data?
So label data is nothing but your where you have, you know, like, already, like this is what my predictor variable. Okay, okay. I need to predict this particular variable.
Okay,
you
sir.
Already know the target.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So yes. I am getting some
chat box.
Yeah. So Dr. Ravi sir, you
before that we have one question from Suresh Chengrayan.
Yeah, please go on.
What is test set in machine learning?
Okay, how much data will you allocate your training, validation, test? So truly speaking, Suresh sir, generally what I do, I just keep on doing 70% and 30%. Out of 30%, you can say I keep on maybe means just for a validation also I keep test. You can say 10% of that. Just means this is the normal way, which normal norm which we follow. It's not hard and fast like where exactly 70 and 30% we do. There are some point where we do 80 and 20 as well. And then we do means like out of that 10% for validation as well. So Rishal, is that clear? There is no hard and fast rule. I'm keep on saying same thing because means it depends on you and your case study. Thank you so much. So Dr. Ravi sir, I would like to know healthcare sector, we are having tiny OS. Can error correction and validation be performed using tiny ML for semi-supervised? Sir, this is actually the domain related question. So I can't comment on the perfect thing, but yeah, you can touch me in offline. Maybe I can give you some other insight on it because people may get confused on because of this. Okay, you can mail me through the comments like you can. I have mentioned my mail ID. You can mention it and maybe you can get from means like what exactly you want. Because it's a quite, you know, related to TinyOS you are saying, and it is quite domain related, which is nothing but the healthcare. Okay. Anyone else, please ask because we have time to take questions and then I can proceed with this. If nobody has questions, please let me know so that I can move forward.
Yes, sir, you just continue, sir. In the middle, okay. If anybody is having that, they will text or they will raise the hand.
Okay, great. Yeah. Anyway, now. I guess Rajesh wanted to speak or who was that?
I think Rajesh sir is not available.
Okay. I don't know. I mean, somebody's voice came up. All of a sudden. Okay. Anyway, now let us move to multiple linear regression. So in real life scenarios, we'll definitely have many more independent variable. Okay. Instead of just one. So to model an equation that studies the relationship between the dependent variable and multiple independent variable, we need to get multiple linear regression. Now, in other terms, we can also say that multiple linear regression is needed when one variable is not sufficient to create a good model and to not make accurate predictions. Okay. Now, the representation equation can be extended like, as I mentioned in previous slide, M0 plus M1X1 plus M2X2 plus M3X3 plus like this, where M0 is the intercept, M1 is the coefficient of variable X1, and M2 is the coefficient of variable X2 and so on. Now, as I mentioned in the linear regression, some assumption in simple linear regression. Now here also there are some assumption, which is nothing but it's almost same, but here the model fits hyperplane instead of the line. Okay, so please be remember this thing, model always here fits the hyperplane instead of a line. The coefficient are still obtained by minimizing the sum of squared error, the least square criteria, which I have showed you. Okay, how exactly you need to minimize that. Now, here the error terms, as I mentioned in the previous, the residual terms are normally distributed with zero mean and independent to each other and have a constant variance. Okay, these criteria will be same for error terms, or maybe you can say for residuals. Now, when you talk about multiple linear regression, we are used to eliminate the relationship between a dependent variable and two or more independent variables. Okay, now for example, the relationship between the salaries of employees and their experience and education. So you can think this case study as a multiple linear regression when you wanted to know the relationship between the salaries of an employee and their experience and education. Okay. Because you know salary of an employee is quite dependent on the experience and their education. So you have done M.Tech, you have done PhD, your salary would be high. Okay, and if you have 10 years of experience, your salary would be much better as compared to the person who has just recently joined the organization. So yeah, here you can see I have just mentioned like what all dependent variables, okay, what all coefficient variables are there, only one dependent variable, sorry. And then how many coefficients are there? Here you can see multiple coefficients and then explanatory variables here as mentioned here. Okay, now, yeah, so multicollinearity, I just wanted to give you some gist about multicollinearity because this problem is generally arise where the overfitting problem is arising here in multiple linear regression, and multicollinearity problem is also arising in multiple linear regression. So the model which has built using several independent variables, you can say some of these variables might be interrelated. There are multiple variables which are quite correlated with each other. Okay, due to that, maybe your model will see some of the variables are quite redundant. Okay, now if it is redundant variables, then how exactly it affects? So it affects like, does change in y when all other are held constant? So do you think the change in y when all other are held constant, okay, whether it is applied or not? What do you mean by that? Suppose coefficients swing wildly, signs can invert. Now therefore p values are not reliable. Okay, here what I am saying, like, therefore p values are not reliable. Now to deal with multicollinearity, you need to do two steps, majorly two steps. So you have to keep on checking the pairwise correlation, okay, whether these two variables are quite correlated with each other or not. If there, then you have to drop one of the variable. Now second thing, you can check variance inflation factor, which is known as VIF. Now there may be a chance, looking at pairwise correlation, which is not enough to actually remove the multicollinearity problem, but instead of just one variable, then an independent variable may depend upon combination of other variables. So if that is the case, then you have to look into the VIF, values of VIF. How exactly? So now VIF calculates how well one independent variable is explained by all other independent variables. So it is generally does how you are going to know one independent variable is explained by all other independent variable combined. So maybe there are two, three variables, a combination of two, three variables, maybe giving you the explanation of one variable. So how will you come to know about that? So VIF, which is nothing but you have to calculate through 1 by 1 minus r square, where I have mentioned here I is nothing but the ith variable, which is being represented by a linear combination of the rest of the independent variables. And the common heuristic we generally use to get VIF value, if the VIF value is greater than 10, then that means value is high and we should eliminate that variable. Okay, and if VIF value is greater than 5, we can be fine, but it is what you can inspect further. But if VIF value is less than 5, that means the VIF value is good, so we don't need to eliminate this variable. Hence this variable is quite not dependent on other variables. So that means you have to keep this variable, you don't need to eliminate this variable. So yeah, as I mentioned here, how you are going to deal with multicollinearity, you need to drop the variable which are highly correlated with each other, okay, and create new variables, derive a features using some of the original features. Now when I am saying like you have to drop the variable which are highly correlated with each other, there is one thing. Now when I am saying you have to derive one variables, so you have to derive one new variables, maybe that variables is being a feature using some of small original features, you can say, maybe. So yesterday I have showed you few things, like, I don't know whether you have observed that or not. So there is one derived features which I have derived from, means like derived feature is BMI. Okay, that is being derived from weight and height. Okay, so when you use weight BMI instead of using weight and height, you can say like two variables are totally dependent on third one. So I'm third one, I'm deriving third variables, which is totally dependent on the two. So now you can remove those variables, and even alone, if you will work with BMI, that is also work. Okay, so that is the one example which I can show you. Means like I have showed you yesterday the same example. Now you have to perform some variable transformation, which is nothing but from using principal component analysis. Now, when you talk about supervised ML classification, let's see first which algorithm comes, or maybe first which regression comes in your mind. It's a logistic regression. So on the same definition for regression, logistic regression is a technique that determines the relationship between a dependent variable and one more independent variable, with the type of dependent being a dichotomous categorical variable, you can say. So you, I don't know, means like how many of you are quite aware about this log of regression or not. So it's just a simple linear regression model only, but on that we are just performing log. So you can see here, while performing log, you are getting p values like this. Okay, so to maximize or minimize a function, we need to differentiate the function and then find the point where the gradient is getting zero. And now, since this is a non-linear function, okay, you can say it is a non-linear function, we use the gradient descent, that is to calculate the gradient of that function at each point we want to optimize and move in the direction toward the negative descent. Or maybe you can say that is to update the value of a parameter. Now, in a simple term, logistic regression, people used to call it logit regression, logit model, or regression model, where the independent variable is categorical. In the beginning only, I have told you this is for categorical variable, you can say. Now, you need to select regression coefficient to force to predict, you can say, value for y to be between 0 and 1. So whatever you will get values in between 0 and 1. And it's you are going to get in S-shaped. Now, probability produce S-shaped regression prediction rather than a straight line. So you will get here like this. Okay. This is of S-shape. So value is 1 here and 0. So it has to be between 0 and 1. Okay. Now, here we are just using sigmoid neuron function, okay, output neuron function, where input is like this and you are just having a S shape, like S function. So now the difference between linear and logistic regression, you can see here. So your value can be predicted y can exceed 0 or 1 is maybe the line comes from here, or maybe the line comes from here. It can be, or maybe it can be 0, but whatever value you will get in logistic regression, it will be between 0 and 1. Okay. Now, supervised ML decision tree. So now, how exactly decision tree you can define? So decision tree is a class of supervised learning algorithm which can be used to predict categorical or continuous variable. Okay. Maybe I will show you this one of the example, maybe in case study, how exactly it is working. Now, for the time being, at least you should think in that way. So decision tree is a class of supervised learning algorithm which can be used to predict the categorical or continuous variable. Okay, I'm going to predict either continuous variable or either categorical variable. How exactly it works? It works by breaking the data from the root node into the smaller and smaller subset while incrementally building the associated decision tree. Now, the final result is a tree with a root node, you can say. And the decision node is nothing but the decision nodes are your word, the lower one, you can say. And a leaf node is ultimately your, you can say, decisions. Now, decision nodes create a rule and leaf node delivers a results. Now, here I can show you the example in which if the weather is sunny, out of sunny, if it is a windy, let's say if it is a windy, then what? Are you getting any rain or not? No. Okay. So here, if sunny, okay, and looks windy, if it doesn't look windy,
sir,
that means.
Sir, sorry to interrupt. Yes. Sir, I think the slide is not changing for the participants, sir. Please make.
Which slide are you able to see? Dinesh, sir.
Sir, I don't know the slide number, but it is simple plus linear plus regression in Python.
Oh, okay.
Sir, once again, try to share your screen once again, sir.
No. Now you are able to see?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So sorry. I don't know what happened actually. Anyway, so yeah. I was just talking about this variance influence factor. I guess you guys have got it. Okay, so, from our side, everything is okay. Me also not able to see PPT, sir. PPT not seen, excellent. Okay, now everyone is able to see. So just I don't know means whether how many of you have gotten my thing. I just talk about multiple linear regression here. I was just telling about like what assumption you need to see. Assumption should be same. It has to be same actually. And here the model fits a hyperplane instead of a line, which I have already talked about. The coefficient are still obtained by minimizing the sum of squared error and the least square criteria. Okay, the error term, which I said, like as usual, like in simple linear regression, the way you have done it, error term has to be normally distributed with the zero mean and independent to each other along with constant variance. Now in multiple regression, I have showed you this. I don't know whether how many of you gotten or not, but yeah, this is the coefficient. You can say like beta 0, beta 1 and beta 2. These are the coefficient and explanatory variables are x1 and x2. Now this is the simple multiple linear regression model. Now in multicollinearity, I must say, slide started with RMSE. No. So guys, I have just stopped you from here onwards. So assumption of linear regression. So from there onwards, I am just going to start with multiple linear regression. Okay. So I have defined you about multiple regression assumptions. Okay. So don't be in a situation like that was there for long. I'm not able to understand what exactly you are saying. Anyway. So multicollinearity, I have talked about it. Now, I don't know how many of you have gotten or not. Variance inflammation, okay. VIF, I don't know whether you have seen or not. Okay, that was there for a long hours. Okay, sorry. So VIF, as I talk about like VIF, calculate how well one independent variable is explained by all the other independent variables, okay. Now VIF is nothing but you can calculate using 1 minus r square, 1 upon 1 minus r square, and I refers to the ith variable, which is being represented as a linear combination of the rest of the independent variable. Now, it's a common heuristic which we follow actually. If VIF is greater than 10, then we definitely should eliminate the variable. And if variable VIF is greater than 5, you can say we can think of it. We can still investigate on it. If VIF value is less than 5, then we can say it's a good VIF and we need to keep this variable. Okay, now let us move on to like variance influence factor. I have told you like how to deal with multicollinearity here. So you just need to drop the variable which are highly correlated with each other. Now create new variable derived features, which I have already told. BMI is one of the best example. You need to create new variables, which is totally dependent, or maybe you can say like highly dependent on two other variables. Maybe you can say derive a feature using some of the original features. Now you need to perform the PCA to deal with multicollinearity. Now I talk about supervised ML classification, which is nothing but our logistic regression. So logistic regression, you know, quite familiar with this log and all. Now, in simple term, I was just talking about this. This should logistic regression should produce S-shaped regression prediction rather than a straight line. You might be getting the straight line for what? For your linear regression, but here you should be getting like this because the value should be between 0 and 1. Okay. Now, I was talking about this, the difference between linear regression and logistic regression. You can see, as I mentioned in the previous, like predicted y can exceed from 0 to 1 range. Okay, it can be lies here, or maybe it can be lies here, like this. But logistic regression, it always lies between 0 and 1. And you can see here, it has to produce like S shape. Now, when you talk about supervised ML, the another thing is decision tree. Now, decision tree are a class of supervised learning algorithm which can be used for predicting categorical or continuous variable, you can say. Now, how does it actually works? So it works by breaking data from root node into smaller and smaller subset, which are incrementally building associated at one decision tree, you can say. The final result of a tree with a root node and DCN nodes and a leaf node. So leaf node generally give you whether you are predicted the right or wrong. Okay. So this is how, means like I'm just giving you one of the, so if like one of the decision you need to take, whether how the outlook is, whether it is a sunny, overcast or rainy. If it is overcast, then you need to say yes, it is overcasted. If it is a rainy, you need to find out whether it's a humid. If it is not humid, means normal, then you can say yes, the season is might be rainy. Now, if it is a sunny, it is a windy, and if it is a windy, then fine. Otherwise, you have to say yes. So this is how it's a just, I'm just giving a gist about like what exactly, how exactly you need to perform decision tree. Now I will take a brief about it. So yeah, so decision tree, type of decision tree, you can say decision tree having classification and regression. So both in classification and regression, you will get ID3 card, C4.5, and there are many more branches which are still exist. Now, building a decision tree, you will be getting these many questions. Okay. First, the pseudocode for building that decision tree is you need to first select a root node. Okay. Once you select the root node, then you have to partition data in respective groups. Okay. So, what all further segmentations are present? Now, once you partition that, now you need to find a decision node. Which one is my decision node? Okay, once you do that, you have to partition data into respective groups again. Okay, so this entire process can be repeated until the node size is greater than threshold, or maybe feature, you can say we are no more with the features, or maybe you can say features is quite empty. Now you must have few questions in your mind. Sir, how we are going to select the root node? How are the decision nodes or order chosen? How exactly we need to choose the order? When does branching stops? How does the tree treat continuous variable? How different is the process for classification and regression? Okay. Now, let us first focus on entropy. Now, entropy measures the homogeneity of the sample. Okay, so the formula is basically I have written over here like P log P minus Q log P base 2. So P is nothing but the probability of the event happening and Q is the probability of the event not happening. So now let us just have a look how it is being done. So consider the problem. We need to predict whether the employee is a techie or a non-techie. So we have 46 techies and non-techie is 15. Now, one of the employees coming, you need to predict whether this employee is techie or non-techie. Now, if you will find P is nothing but probability of techie is what? 0.75. Okay. And probability of non-techie is 0.25. Now, you need to find entropy of an employee. Now, entropy of an employee is being calculated using entropy of 46,15 is being calculated using minus P log P minus Q log Q. So minus P log P is 0.75 log 0.75 minus 2.5 log 2.5, which is nothing but the 0.8. So the entropy of employee, you are getting 0.8. Now, here you have another attributes which is saying, which is defined like this, dress codes, techie, non-techie, formal, casual, business casuals, and total is here. Now, you wanted to find entropy of an employee dress code. Now, how do you find entropy of employee dress code? Now, you need to find first probability of a formals and then entropy of the formals plus probability of the casuals into entropy of the casuals. How do you get entropy of the formals and entropy of the casuals? You have to find the same way you have done the entropy of the employee. Same way you have to find entropy of the formals. Okay. Now, entropy of the formals is nothing but here 6,8. The way here 46,15. Now, you will have to perform like minus 6 log 6 minus 8 log 8. You will get some value. You have to place it. Now, probability of formals is what? Probability of formals is nothing but here the total value is what? 14. Okay. Now, either it is a techie or either it is a non-techie. You have a formals total 14. Now, 14 divided by 61 as the total is 61. Now, this one. Now, you are getting probability of employee for a dress code. Now, you are getting 68. Now, you need to find gain. How to find gain? It's nothing but the entropy of employee minus entropy of a dress code of that employee. So you have already gotten entropy of employee, which is nothing but the 0.8, and the entropy of dress code of employee is 0.61, which is 0.11. You are getting the gain. Okay. So this is the entire process which you need to perform while doing the re-entry. You need to calculate entropy and all. So now here you can see. So employee is techie or non-techie? Employee's average working hours. So now you can see here dress code. So the dress code is casual, business casual, formals. Now formal, if their dress code is formal, then with gender, what type of gender it is? It is a male or female? If it is a male, then you are just saying techie. Why? Based on the data. Now, employee average working hour. So you are just looking at dress code. Now, casual, business casual, and formal. You are seeing all the three. Now you are seeing 25 observation belongs to this, 20 observation belongs to this, 55 belongs to this. So more observation belongs to formal. Now you drill down further. Now you just see whether gender is male or female. So how many observations belongs to males? How many observations belongs to female? Okay. Out of that, you are just getting 10 working hour or 8 working hour. Here the 12 and 9. So this is how you need to drill down your question. See, most important thing while building a re-entry, you keep on asking the questions by yourself. Okay. That is how you will do that. That is how you will build re-entry. So yeah, as I mentioned here, so classification example, like we have categorical here, continuous is this one, and class. So you need to predict this cheat or not. So you have this test set, you can say you have these values. You wanted to find this cheat, means this categorical call. Okay. Now, based on this, if something is yes, and it is a married and taxable income is, let's say, 120k. So if it is yes, and if it is a married, so how many are yes and married? Oh, only one. And if it is a 50k, what exactly the cheat is, whether he will cheat or not? You can see whether he will cheat or not. It is mentioned like no, but taxable income is 120k. Okay. So you have to think about that. And if there is no single 40k, single, you can say no single 85k, no single 90k, no single 70k. Okay. So these are the key values. So now you have to, how this is how you have to just, I just wanted to show you how exactly the training set looks like and how is it the test set look like. What is your classifier here, your decision tree classifier, and what is going to be predicted here. So once you build the model, you have to pass the test set and it will predict you. Okay. So yeah, basically let's just have a look of classification application. I don't know whether you guys are means like I observed my PPT. In my PPT I have mentioned like in classification, like whether mail is spam or non-spam. So yeah, here I have mentioned one of the application is like in Gmail you are getting whether it's spam or non-spam. Now application, another application which you can say like you just wanted to classify whether the person is moving, it's a vehicle or it's a pedestrian detection. So you have to just classify. Now you wanted to classify the number, optical character recognition. This is one of the class of, you can say, application. Now let us move to unsupervised learning. Now when we talk about unsupervised learning, the first thing comes in our mind is clustering. The key objective in clustering is to identify distinct group, or maybe you can say clusters, based on some notion of similarity within a given data set. Okay, so now you need to know like what type of clustering actually. So there are two types of clustering, which is known as hierarchical clustering and k-means clustering. Now hierarchical we used to say agglomerative, and k-means we used to say it as a divisive. Okay, now what is k-mean clustering? So k-mean clustering, you need to start with a random point initialization of the required number of centers. Okay, that means k in k-mean stand for the number of clusters. Okay, so you need to start the random point initialization of the required number of centers. You need to know like how many centers you need to you actually require. So here the number of clusters first, then assign each data point to the center. You have to assign each data point to the center. Now which is quite closer to it. So means there are multiple data points which are scattered across. Now each point you have to make it to the assigned to the center, or that center has to, which is quite near to it. So you can say like here I am going to use normal Euclidean distance for to get that distance metric, means to know the which one is closest. Now you have to recalculate the center by averaging the dimension of the point belonging to the cluster, and make sure you need to repeat the new center until we reach a point where the assignment becomes stable. Okay. Now when it talks about hierarchical clustering, you need to start with the n clusters, means n is nothing but the number of data points. Okay, now you have to combine the two closest cluster, and you have to again combine another two closest cluster. Same you have to do repeatedly until you get one single cluster. So this is how I recommend, means you have multiple cluster and then you have keep on combining two clusters at once, you can say. I will show you in the diagram, I guess. Yeah, so yeah, clustering, task of grouping a set of objects. Okay, that's what I said. It's a task of grouping a set of objects. Here the object in the same group called a cluster. Okay, so here if objects present here are in the same group, then that is called as a cluster. This is one cluster, this is another cluster, this is another cluster. You can say these are the different five clusters, you can see. Now more similar to each other than the other two other group of clusters. So that is why we can differentiate. These are quite interrelated with each other, and it has a maximum distance between other cluster. Okay, these data points are quite closer to each other, but it has a maximum distance between other two clusters. So best application, when you search about something, maybe you are, let's say you are searching about election, or maybe let's say you are searching about COVID-19, all the news which is related to COVID-19 are going to be scattered at one place, means you will get in top 10 result, means like in Google, all the COVID related news. How? Because it is just searching the COVID term. Okay, COVID term into the search, and then all the news which is coming into that will come out. So if you have a doubt, like, sir, which page will come first and which page will come later, then that is a different thing, because Google is having their own algorithm, which is known as page rank algorithm. Means actually that algorithm, how exactly it works, the page which hits more, they keep on increasing the rank of that page. Okay, if suppose one page is having hit of 100 or maybe 1000 times, then they will give first rank. Then there is another page which has just hit of 70 or maybe 700, then they will give a rank of second page. So that is how then Google displays the pages in your whatever search you have performed. So now you can see, like, group of similar items placed at one place. Okay, now next is, yeah, so this I already talked about association rule mining. I don't know how many of you got that, but association rule mining is a procedure to find frequent pattern, correlation, and associations or a causal structures from a data set. So the algorithm is, you have item set, the list of all transactions like milk, bread, apple, oranges, milk. These are the item sets. Now, support is number of times an item appear in a data set. Okay, so you need to just count how many times these particular items are occurred in your data set. Now, let's say support milk, bread, the number of transactions will milk and bread divided by total number of transactions. So now you need to find how many transactions are happened in milk and bread. And then you will also find these many transactions are happened with milk and bread. Suppose you have walked to the DMart and your friend is also walked to the DMart. Now you have bought milk and bread and your friend just bought milk. And maybe your friend has just bought bread. Maybe, let's say. Now, next time again you have gone, then the number means you have bought milk and bread and your friend is also bought milk and bread. Now, total number of transactions has happened is total 4. Out of that, 3 transactions are happened with milk and bread. That means this will calculate 3 divided by 4. Okay, this is how the calculation is happening. Now, the confidence, the measure of number of times a rule is found to exist in the data set, that is the confidence. So here the support of milk and bread, whatever you got, 3 and 3 by 4, divided by the support of milk. The support of milk is what? It is a 4. Okay, because 4 times you have bought 4 milk. So you can say, like, it's a pretty much, you know, algorithm. I'm just giving you overview of that. And the main application, as I said, market basket analysis in all the, you know, shop, even in malls or even in your whatever means showroom you are going to visit, everywhere you will see same analysis. Okay, and cross sell and upsell. I don't know whether you guys are quite aware about this cross sell and upsell. So it's a cross sell and upsell which is used in banking domain, you can say, where, how exactly, if customer has bought one insurance or maybe he has bought one insurance, life insurance or something, then all the insurance which is quite related to that is going to pitch. Means people will pitch that insurance, like, sir, means like, can you take this also insurance? It has some additional benefit apart from your insurance. So like nowadays, if you are going to buy health insurance, then people will come up with, bank will display you, no, COVID related also insurance is quite given so many people. So you can also take this. And this is how, or maybe you can say, like, when you are going to shop in your Amazon or maybe Flipkart, suppose you are buying some item. So, you know, like, if you go down, you will easily see, like, if they have written now, customer who bought this can bought this thing as together. So maybe they are just doing association rule mining. So they are just displaying, maybe there are multiple customers who bought laptop along with maybe keyboard and mouse, maybe. And then they are showing us, if the customer has bought laptop, then they are also bought, you know, means like getting, and they are also interested in getting a keyboard and this mouse. So this is how actually association rule mining works. Okay, now this, we don't have much time now. We just have another 2 minutes. So what I'm asking you to ask questions, if you have, please do raise your voice and you raise, otherwise we will take up next further case study. And you can say case study and the next topic in the from two to four. Yeah, any question, please. Very well appreciated if you will ask. I don't know how many of you are hungry. May might be because of that you are not able to ask. So if you don't have question, please let me know. Or else if you have question, please place it in our chat box. Okay. So no question, Dinesh sir?
Yes sir, we will go for the...
Yeah, so it's better. People are might hungry and they haven't taken their breakfast, I guess.
Yeah.
So yeah. Might be. Yeah, okay. So then much, we can again. Okay.
Yeah, ma'am, you can continue, ma'am.
Thank you very much, sir, for such an engrossing session. I would like to inform all the participants that afternoon session will be commencing at 2 p.m. So make it convenient to join the session when the clock strikes 2. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am.